Mr. President, shortly the two leaders of this chamber will be heading to the White House to update the President on discussions over keeping the government funded and up and running past the end of the fiscal year, which is September the 30th. And I want to remind our colleagues briefly how we ended up in this situation, why it is we're talking about a short-term continuing resolution from this point to December the 9th, and then revisiting the issue beyond that by December the 9th. It's pretty clear that everybody understands a CR, as we call it around here, a continuing resolution, is really a short gap, a stopgap spending bill to fund the government. And it's the result of our Democratic colleagues filibustering the regular appropriations process. As the presiding officer knows, there are 12 appropriations bills that need to be considered by each of the appropriations subcommittees, and then they're voted on by the committee itself, and then they come to the floor of the United States Senate, where we take them up in a transparent and orderly sort of way, each of those 12 bills, or at least that's the plan. We brought up bill after bill to do just exactly that this year, and this is the first time since 2009 that all 12 bills have been voted out of the committee and now available for us to act upon. That's the way the legislative process is supposed to work, and that's the way that is transparent to the American people, so they know exactly what we're doing, and they can call us and say, we don't like that, or they can call us and they say, well, I do like that. But the point of it is, this is far superior to short-term continuing resolutions or the dreaded omnibus bill, which we had to deal with last year, again, as a result of our inability to get the appropriations process to work. But this year, our Democratic colleagues stopped the regular orderly process of passing appropriations bills, and you might ask, for what purpose? Well, it's pretty obvious that their purpose was to make sure that they had maximum leverage in order to force the federal government to spend more money, not just on national security matters, which would enjoy a lot of support on this side of the aisle, but to use any increase in national security spending to leverage more non-defense discretionary spending, breaking the caps that had been agreed upon in a bipartisan way previously. So this is the reason why we find ourselves here in this distasteful and unpleasant position, Democratic obstruction. And so now we are forced to deal with a short-term stopgap bill, which is nobody's first solution. It's not my second or third, but it's something we must deal with, and we will. Separately, Mr. President, yesterday our country observed the 15th anniversary of the terrorist attacks on the World Trade Center and at the Pentagon and in a field in Pennsylvania where brave patriots brought down this plane rather than allow it to come to the Capitol and create or cause other damage and perhaps loss of life. We know that about 3,000 Americans died just in the attack on the World Trade Center. All of us remember where we were on that day. I certainly do. And only other time in my life that I can tie back to a historic and sad event like that was when John F. Kennedy was killed when I was in junior high school. I remember exactly where I was when President Kennedy was assassinated. And so it is, I remember exactly where I was and what I was doing when those planes hit the World Trade Center and those 3,000 Americans lost their lives. It's important for us to send a message that that evil shall not prevail. Americans from all backgrounds came together in a beautiful display of patriotism and fraternity following that terrible day of September the 11th, 2001. And of course, following those attacks, the United States took military and diplomatic action to bring justice, not only to those families, but to demonstrate the consequences of attacking the American homeland. But the truth is, the victims and their families still don't have the ability to get justice from the people including the governments who helped fund those terrorist attacks. And that's where the bill, the Justice Against Sponsors of Terrorism Act, comes into play, because if this legislation is signed by the president, it will become the law of the land. It will amend the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act in a way that will allow Americans to sue state sponsors of terrorism when the terrorist attack occurs on American soil. Believe it or not, under the current law, that can't happen. And so this law is one that's designed to make sure that these families who are still grieving and still don't have closure will be able to seek justice in a court of law against the people who killed their loved one on September the 11th. This is a bipartisan bill. My primary co-sponsor in the Senate is Senator Schumer from New York. Matter of fact, this is so bipartisan as to be nonpartisan. It passed the United States Senate by unanimous consent. Any individual senator who wanted to could stand up and say, "I object," and it wouldn't have happened, but nobody did. And so by unanimous consent, we passed this legislation in the United States Senate. And last Friday, in the United States House of Representatives, it passed without any objection. It passed unanimously. I know it's pretty hard for people to actually believe that anything gets passed unanimously here in Washington in this polarized political environment, but this bill was passed unanimously. Now, just after the anniversary of these tragic attacks, the Justice Against Sponsors of Terrorism Act is headed to the president's desk, perhaps as early as today. This legislation will give victims of terror attacks and their families the opportunity to seek justice in a court of law from those who fund and facilitate terrorist attacks. Now, I just want to make clear, contrary to some of the reports, this legislation doesn't mention any foreign government at all. It's agnostic. What it says is if you fund and facilitate a terrorist attack on American soil, you can be hauled into court to answer for your crimes. And the families can seek compensation as they would in any other personal injury or wrongful death lawsuit. This is a straightforward piece of legislation that simply provides the mechanism to help victims of terrorist attacks on U.S. soil find the justice they need. The American people, through their elected representatives, have been clear in their support for this legislation. Unfortunately, President Obama has already threatened to veto it. And for what reason, I simply am at a loss to say. But I want to point out this isn't just strictly, this veto threat isn't about a president and his soured relationships with Congress. It's about the victims of 9/11 who've made clear that they deserve to have this avenue of justice made into law. Again, this legislation doesn't mention any particular country, and it doesn't decide the merits of any claim that these family members may have. That's left to our justice system as it should be. Just yesterday, the families of the 9/11 victims sent a letter imploring President Obama to sign this bill. This is a powerful letter, and I'd like to ask that the full text, Mr. President, of the letter be submitted for the record following my remarks.
Without objection.
The families talk openly in this letter about the grief that they still feel, not just on the anniversary of 9/11, but every single day. And they talk about why justice is so important and how this legislation would help ensure that, quote, justice delayed for the 9/11 families will not become justice denied. And they're right. That justice may have been delayed, but it will not be denied under this bill. At the end of the letter, they plead with President Obama and ask him not, and I quote, to slam the door shut and abandon us. We need the executive branch to join Congress and protect us and all future victims of terrorism. Please, they say, sign JASTA. These victims have certainly been through a lot, and they certainly have the strength of their conviction. And I admire the courage that they display every single day to get up in the morning and go on about their lives in the aftermath of so much loss and so much tragedy. The least we can do is to make JASTA law so that they and others in the future can have access to the courts and a path to justice. Again, this bill doesn't decide the case. That's left to the court of law. It doesn't target an individual country. It says that any country who sponsors and facilitates and funds terrorist activities on American soil can be called to answer for it in court. I find it, frankly, baffling that President Obama would rather make life easier for state sponsors of terrorism than he would lend support to the families of 9/11. He should sign this bill, and it's an overwhelming display of support here in Congress on behalf of the American people, and I hope he reconsiders his previously threatened veto. But if President Obama does veto it, don't leave the American people and the victims of terrorism in limbo. If he's going to veto this legislation, he should not delay so that Congress can quickly consider whether to override that veto and make the Justice Against Sponsors of Terrorism the law of the land. There is a way that if the president decided to play games with the victims of 9/11 and these families who've suffered so much, that he could make it hard, if not impossible, for Congress to vote to override the veto. But one thing he can do, out of respect for them and the memory of their lost loved ones, is to go ahead and veto it, if that's his determination, and to send it back here and then let Congress vote to override the veto, which I'm confident we will.